Hello, everybody. My name is Siri Belenki, and I'm a program director of Harvard Ukrainian Summer Institute. I'm happy to announce the beginning of our weekly summer seminar series. The seminars will take place on Fridays, right here on Zoom, from 1:15 p.m. to 2:45 p.m. Eastern Time in US and Canada. So again, do your math and add a few hours if you locate it in Ukraine or elsewhere in Europe. We have a very diverse program for you. Our first speaker in the series is Dr. Marianna Dushar. She's a Fulbright scholar from Lviv, Ukraine, where she is the head of the Ukrainian Culinary Heritage Project called Seeds and Roots. She worked on it while being on Fulbright here in the United States. She's also a member of the Club of Galician Cuisine. In addition, Dr. Dushar runs a popular YouTube blog called Pani Stefa, devoted to the traditional and contemporary cuisine of Galicia, a region of Western Ukraine known for its unique cultural and culinary legacy. The city of Lviv is indeed the food capital of Ukraine, and those of you who had a chance to visit the city, you probably will agree with me. One of Dr. Dushar's current projects is the book on Galician noble cuisine that she's been working on together with Igor Lilo, a famous Lviv historian. So be prepared that Dr. Dushar will bust some of your deeply seated myths and stereotypes about the Ukrainian cuisine. You think you know the Ukrainian cuisine? Think twice. After Dr. Dushar's presentation, you will all be able to ask your questions. Students through Zoom and a wider audience through the YouTube channel. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Dushar among us, silently muted, I guess.
Hello.
Please, Pani Marianna.
Hello, everyone. Thank you very much, Serhii, for the introduction. First of all, let me thank Professor Serhii Pluhi for this honor and opportunity to be here today, and you, Pane Serhii, for support to organize this lecture. I am one of the first who will speak here on such an unusual topic. Give me a second, please. I will share my presentation. And we will start. So, I want to start this lecture with this photo. It was taken during Euro 2012. When the Portuguese football team arrives in Lviv. Look at the Ronaldo's expression. He's one of the most famous superstar player and seems completely confused. He doesn't have a clue of what to do with that huge bread in his hands. Well, if I were there, I would be able to give him a short lecture, something like that I have prepared for you today. Why is the history and anthropology of food is so relevant for Ukraine today? Because the Ukrainian people whose ancestors survived the multiplied terrible traumas, wars, and artificial famines are looking for their identity, even through the gastronomic heritage. 17 years of Soviet occupation brought many things to Ukraine, including humiliation through food. Despite its declared respect for the traditional culture of all people of the USSR, the Soviet regime created an universal so-called Soviet cuisine for universal Soviet people. As a result, many dishes lost their nationality. For example, Ukrainian borscht became an all-union dish. The same fate was suffered by chibureks of the Crimean Tatars, the shashliks of the Georgians, the plow from the Uzbeks, and so on. My interviews here in the United States show that people often consider these dishes simply as a traditional Russian food, which is simply not true. All these artificially created narratives are still very much alive. Even now, almost 30 years after the collapse of the Soviet Union, nostalgia is for so-called true quality and childhood taste is used as a marketing ploy to manipulate people. And it works. It works even among young people who have no idea what the USSR really was. It works even here in the United States. All you have to do is look at the shelves of so-called Russian stores. Imagine spring 2020, New York, a giant supermarket of nostalgia, Soviet propaganda, objectification, and even racism. However, nostalgia can also be productive if it is nourished not by the heritage of the occupier, but the sources of native culture. That is why, for several years now, my colleague, Professor Igor Lilo, and I have been researching archival materials related to food, assembling a library, and studying the old pre-Soviet cookbooks and notebooks of Ukrainian families. Our colleague from Kyiv, Dr. Olena Braichenko, is developing an educational project on the gastronomic history of Ukraine. An important part of our work is teaming up with chefs to learn how to work properly with culinary heritage. Because Ukrainian cuisine deserves to be known not only for stereotypical borscht, bread with sallow and vodka, because even borscht can be contemporary. However, the specific topics of my lecture today is two very significant gastronomic brands of Ukraine, bread and borscht. Bread was a food of necessity for humans because it was edible requirement for life. Bread making and consuming happened because of the natural laws of survival. For our Ukrainian ancestors, bread processed and became a food of opportunity. Bread making and the varieties that developed from the vast nature of fertile lands. It gave way to concurrent development of Ukrainian culture. The large variety of Ukrainian bread reflects the taste and identity of Ukrainian people. Bread runs the gamut from the mundane everyday food to sacred breads that were identifying markers for cultural rituals. Borscht was a food of opportunity. Many cultures developed liquid food by manipulating and combining the edible object of fair lands. Borscht was created in our lands precisely because it is here that its necessary components and are combined according to the taste of the inhabitants. Bread is the basis of Ukrainian culture economy. The most fertile lands of Europe, mentioned by Herodotus, and which could feed millions of people in the world. They are a blessing for Ukraine, but also at times became a curse. And numerous aggressors throughout history attempt to usurp these fertile lands for themselves. Borscht is one of the most varied dishes of Ukrainian cuisine. It is a topic of endless disputes between territories and even countries about its authenticity and the right to be called the borscht homeland. The image of Ukraine as a breadbasket of Europe is not new. For centuries, fertile land have amazed foreigners traveling to Ukraine. Please pay attention to the sites on the slide. They all admired the fertile lands of Ukraine and the pleasant climate, and especially noted the skills of people. Everyone here knows how to work with land, sow, harvest, and bake bread. From among many different travel notes and chronicles, I want to draw your attention to these two. First is the incredible mention of Lviv's bread. It is described by Martin Gruneberg, a merchant from Gdansk who visited Lviv. It is very valuable for me because my main topic of interest is the cuisine of Galicina and Lviv. The second one is from the traveler and the archdeacon Paul from Aleppo, who made his way through the Ukraine to Moscow. Particularly interesting is the depiction of the custom of welcoming bread. In 16th, 17th century, the development of Ukraine resource Chornozeme, or so-called black earth, begins. At that time, Ukraine was a part of Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth and became a major exporter of grain. And the port of Gdansk became one of the largest trade centers. Chroniclers of that time wrote about the huge wheat harvest, so large that is what was enough for both bread and vodka production. Yields were high, but the price of grain was cheap. In the years of extra prosperity, for example, in 1771 and 1784, chronicles write about, I quote, giant mountains of rotten wheat in Volyn. At the end of 18th century, serdom was introduced in the Livobrezhna Ukraina, which was ruled by Russian Empire. The Russian Empire acquired a new resource, serfs, and the grain grown by them. The main area of grain production was Podilia in central Ukraine. And through the port of Odessa, the empire began to trade in grain with the Mediterranean. In the beginning of 18th century, Ukrainian bread shows up on the European market. In general, by the middle of 19th century, Ukraine, including Ukrainian grain, accounted for 75% of all export of the Russian Empire. The interesting facts of the role is the role of German Mennonites colonists in the history of Ukrainian bread. In 1786, at the invitation of Empress Katerina, they began to settle along the shores of the Sea of Azov and growing varieties of winter durum wheat. Then, in 1970, the Imperial Russian government announced the new policy for German settlements: one king, one religion, one language. And the Mennonites immigrated to America, mostly to Kansas. They brought with them to America not only the technology of growing winter wheat, but also the Ukrainian grain. It became the basis of the American granary. The abolition of serfdom in the Russian Empire in 1861 gave a boost to the economy. Wealth increased and wealthy Ukrainian peasants became players in the bread and sugar market. However, the First World War and the Bolshevik coup led to the first famine in Ukraine in 1921. Fortunately, with the help of the United States, the effects of this famine were quickly eliminated. But in 1932, Stalin began a planned war against Ukrainian farmers, the Holodomor of death by hunger of 1932-33 took more than 6 million people's lives. It seems ironic that the breadbasket of Europe would experience a famine. Europe and the world knew and were silent and kept buying Ukrainian grain. The famine changed the economy and even the character of Ukrainians for decades. This trauma of the famine runs very deep. People whose families survived the Holodomor have exhibited the pathologically unhealthy attitude towards food. Their irrational fear of hunger drives them to panic buying, hoarding of food, and overconsumption of it. But today, the ritual and spiritual meaning of bread is also quite important. Bread in our culture is more than simply food. It is a sacred object, a talisman, a symbolic sacrifice and incarnation of deity. Bread is a synonymous with well-being and food in general. Did you note the similarity of the Ukrainian words for rye and to live, zhito and zhity? The vam of bread and farming is presented in folk art, for example, Easter eggs, ceramic tiles, and fine arts. There are also many proverbs about bread, such as, without bread, even loaf fades, bread is the head of everything, and you are my brother, but eat your own bread. Bread accompanies the life of Ukrainians from birth to death. A newborn child was given bread to put under his head as a sign of life and a knife in defense of evil. The wedding bread, korovai, is more than bread. It is a symbolic language. The korovai had a following function. It would use it as a symbol of consent to marriage, as an invitation guest to the wedding, as a blessing of the young couples, as a symbol of the union of two families, and a symbol of the consecration of the marriage bed. Almost every event in the ceremonial year of Ukrainians had its intended bread. Many practices persist to this day. Please take a look on the slide. Here are just a few of them. This is a greeting bread, so called Vitalny Chleb, and Christmas collage, Rizdvyanny collage. The symbolism and peculiarities of baking ritual bread deserves a separate lecture. Bread also accompanied people who were departing this earth. Small breads were placed in the folds of garment of the deceased. Kolovo or a porridge made with wheat and honey was served at the wake. A special commemorative bread was the pomana. The soul of departed was sent on its way with a pomana, lit candles, and a collage. The pomana was also brought to the cemetery. It was customary to bake bread after the funeral because it was said, I quote, the soul of deceased is fed with the spirits of bread. The Galician and Lviv cuisine are closer to me, so it is specifically interesting for me to tell you about what breads were baked in Lviv, at least in 13th century. It was a rye or wheat bread, so called razovi, from the flour sifted ones. Rye or wheat bread, so called pitlovany, from well-sifted flour. Sukhari, specially baked and oven drying bread. Bagels, so called obvazhanki, pretzel and bubliki. Cakes fried in oil with cheese, poppy seeds and saffron. Pastries wrapped in cheese and braided. Honey cakes and gingerbread. What bread Ukrainians consume depends on many factors: the time period and region, urban or rural tradition, daily or ritual purposes. For example, my consultant Katya Kalyuzhna from the city of Kakhovka says that in general, wheat bread predominated in the south of Ukraine. Rye was not sown due to the very hot climate. She shared a recipe for a traditional polonaise, which has been baked in her family for several generations. The recipe is adapted to modern products and baking conditions. Of course, bread has changed over the centuries. The quality of flour has changed. Technology has changed. People's taste preferences have changed. But the general attitude of Ukrainians to bread has not changed. We still bake korovai and paskha. We kiss a piece of bread that has fallen to the ground. We teach our children to do this. Bread and salt are traditional greetings in Ukraine. According to old beliefs, this will defend our homes from the evil. Now it became a traditional gesture of Ukrainian hospitality. We can find its description in many historical, ethnographical, and literature sources. For example, in Ivan Kotlyarevsky's burlesque poem Eneida, the main character Enei sent his parliamentaries to the Tsar Latin with bread and salt. Латину тільки що сказали, що от Енея єсть посли, із хлібом сіллю причвалали та і подарки принесли. Хотять Латину поклониться, знакомитись і подружитися. For those who research Ukrainian culture generally and Ukrainian gastronomic specifically, the Eneida is an invaluable resource. The author transforms the Trajan heroes into Zaporozhian Cossacks and filled the work with Ukrainian ethnographic flavor. One of my particular interest are the description of ancient Ukrainian dishes and local food specialities. In this quote, you can see very, very special Ukrainian foods and local specialities. For example, korovai, opishnyansky slivy, smazhenie kyivsky gorikhy, poltavsky pundiky. It is all very local and old tradition to bake or prepare them. Eneida is so rich with food reference that it could almost be a topic for its own lecture. But let's talk about borscht. Because in Eneida we can find the word borscht in a very broad sense, as a food in general. In our bread part, we saw the word bread was used in the same way as a general term for food. And this is not the only common feature of between bread and borscht. The basis of both is fermentation, dough for bread and kvass for borscht. Like bread, borscht has both utilitarian and ritual significance. And we cannot overestimate the importance of bread and borscht in our daily culture. They are commonly used as a synonym of the comfort of home. I'd like to play for you a short video about the making of summer borscht. Please enjoy.
Thank you.
I hope you enjoy this video as much as we did while making it. The oldest recipe, which is similar to borscht, was recreated from Babylonian writings just 2 years ago during the event called Appetite from the Past. This event was hosted by the Institute of Study of the Ancient World of the New York University. In fact, it was a lamb stew with beetroot, but team members named it proto borscht. But what was this actually borscht as we know it? Probably not. It is just an illustration of how long ago humans ate beets and what dishes they created using them. Beets came to Eastern European land from the Mediterranean, where beet leaves were used as food from the ancient time. Beets with round, sweet, red roots appeared around 20th century and spread to Eastern Europe in 16th century. That is why it seems almost comical that have been attempts to prove that borscht was food eaten during the Kyivan Rus times, which existed from the 9th to 13th century. Obviously, people who lived in the Kyivan Rus Empire could have eaten soups and other liquid meals which could contain beets leaves, but it was not borscht as we know it. It seems that every single person in Ukraine claims to be an expert of borscht. Borscht is a universal meal which unites everyone. In a sort of litmus test to determine who is one of us and who isn't. At the same time, it is the cause of the many arguments centered of what is the real, one and only authentic borscht. I will say this upfront: there is no one and only authentic borscht. From my research, I see that borscht recipes are almost never found in handwritten cookbooks. I think this is because no housewife considers borscht as a dish which needs a recipe. As I said before, borscht is a food of opportunity. It is cooked based on available products and developed by taste. There are many versions of borscht. They can be so different that even Ukrainians who have grown up deeply immersed in a borscht culture are surprised by its diversity. I put together a few charts to illustrate this diversity. First of all, we can divide borscht in three main groups: red, green, and white. This is rather simplistic division, as you will see later. The basic examples are division is the average red borscht, green sorrel borscht, and white borscht, also called jour. Borscht differs in density, which depends on regional tradition and private preferences. A good example of liquid drinkable borscht is the so-called pansky borscht. It serves in the cups and also known under the name consomme borscht. In terms of temperature, borscht can be called so-called holodnik and hot. From my observation, holodniki are more popular in Western Ukraine. Depending on the base, borscht can be vegetarian as well as cooked on meat broth. The basis for meatless borscht can be water, some kvass, vegetables, mushroom, and or fish broth. Poultry and different meat broth are the basis for the meat borscht. An interesting base for meat borscht, especially for white borscht, is a smoked meat, sausages and the water in which they were cooked. Observations show and field studies confirm that the taste profile of Ukrainian borscht fluctuates within the sweet and sour scale. Regional and private recipes can be more sour or sweeter. There are many components which determine the final taste of borscht. The oldest acidifier was a variety of kvass, first prepared on the basis of herbs and later beet kvass or bread kvass. Then tomatoes came to our lands. They became one of the most popular agents of sour taste of borscht. A very interesting variable is the creation of borscht and products that are local or simply available. In areas adjusted to rivers or lakes, it is a fish which is dried in straw or salted. A local speciality of Podilsky borscht is a smoked pears. My favorite addition is a prune and mushroom dumplings, also known as vushka, for the vegetarian borscht on Christmas Eve. And obviously, all the ingredients that we put in the borscht are reflected in its color. Moreover, the correct color of the mythological one and only true borscht is also a topic for discussion. The diagram shows the main color agents of borscht. The importance of borscht in Ukrainian cuisine can also be seen because of its ritual significance. Borscht must be served at the weddings. Borscht is cooked at the memorial service. Vegetarian borscht is one of the mandatory 12 dishes on Christmas Eve. Even today, for many families, borscht is a main dish of the family Sunday dinner. But my favorite example of the exceptional meaning of borscht is this one photo. It is a free borscht prepared in a celebration of Stalin's death. It seems that Jews were instrumental in spreading borscht on the territory of Eastern Europe. This soup is being inexpensive and very accessible and became a favorite. In fact, even today, the greatest number of borscht variation can be seen in the Pale of Settlement. The spread of borscht to Western Europe owes its thanks to European chefs who time to time worked in nobility homes on Eastern Europe. These chefs later returned home and presented variation of borscht as a foreign curiosity. A classic example of this would be a story of Antoine Marie Carême. When he returned home to France, he created his own version of an extravagant borscht. Later, the famous Escoffier, who was obsessed with the beautiful ruby color of borscht, simplified his recipe and introduced his own version of borscht to the French culinary world. Eventually, borscht made its way across the ocean. In the United States, borscht became popular as one of the most beloved Jewish dishes. It is interesting that there are also a recipe for Mennonite borscht that the Mennonites themselves call as Ukrainian borscht. They most likely brought borscht back with them when they returned to the United States from Ukraine in 19th century. Borscht is also spreading through the internet and social media. Even Princess Diana said that she loved to eat Ukrainian borscht. In Ukraine, it is considered polite when saying goodbye to your host to thank them for the bread and salt. So, дякую за кліпсіль, and thank you for your attention. So, and I need to...
Thank you so much, Pani Marianna. That was excellent, excellent, excellent presentation. We learned a lot, and hopefully all participants will have a lot of questions. Hopefully they're hungry for answers, and also hungry too.
In normal way, when I make some presentation, I give my audience something to try. Some if we will have similar lecture in different circumstances, I will prepare some borscht and some chleb as a sample of taste.
Well, maybe that will be the task for our summer school students. So maybe they should prepare something at homes. I have already one pre-submitted question from our viewer on YouTube. It's from Nicholas Slaby, who was a participant in our summer school. I quote, I have heard that traditional borscht was made from sorrel, purslane, and nettle. Beets were incorporated much later. Is this correct?
This is mostly correct. This was a very big part of my version 1.0 of my presentation, but I cut it because my lecture will never end. So there is a few theories about borscht, about origins of borscht. One of the theories said that borscht was made from fermented herbs, especially so it calls cow parsnip, like borscht. It is very common wild herb in on the old territory of Eastern Europe. So maybe sorrel borscht was later, because I'm not sure about how then sorrel is accessible in our cuisine. But I think in the first base borscht was on some fermented herbs. And later these fermented herbs and kvass made of them, they still are in the base of our borscht now.
Thank you so much. We have another question from, a comment rather actually, from another viewer on YouTube, Alexandra G. Quote, I saw rhubarb as one of the ingredients in the video.
Yes. This is a, if you can remember, I had a chart about acidity agents of in borscht. Rhubarb is one of these acidity agents, as well as, for example, sour cherry juice. It can be any sour base can be added to the borscht to its sour taste. And rhubarb is one of them. And especially in summer borscht, rhubarb is a very common ingredient, especially in my region and in my family. We use rhubarb very often.
Thank you very much. I want to remind the students who are here via Zoom, please, if you want to ask a question, raise your hand. This is the Zoom option. And I have a first question from Olga Stasiuk. So please, Olga.
Thank you so much for your lecture. It was really interesting. I wanted to ask, can you please elaborate about some unusual ingredients? For example, I saw strawberries and ginger. Yeah. So which territories use these ingredients, and actually why?
Strawberries is not, thank you for the question at first. Strawberries is not very common components, but I know about local traditional in Poltava region to add strawberries in their borscht. I think it can be explained by very simple example. They have strawberries and they add it. I think it maybe partly because of sour taste of strawberries, but maybe it's just like an experiment which was produced for a long time. The second about ginger. Ginger is also very interesting component. It I noticed ginger in few Ukrainian Jewish recipe of borscht, and I tried it added it myself, and it also it is very tasty. And I think ginger can be added just to add some much flavor to borscht, especially when borscht is cooked on a not meat base, just to enrich the taste, I think. Thank you for question.
Thank you. Do you have any other questions? So please don't be shy. Betsy, I see Betsy Fawcett. Please, could you ask a question? Yes.
Yeah, it's less of a question and more of a comment. But when I lived in Ukraine, I often heard people would say, like, a man's favorite borscht is his mother's, and that's all he'll ever eat, or that's all he'll ever love. And I think the diversity in borscht that you showed us probably explains some of that sentiment, that what you grow up with could be very different to eat later in your life.
Thank you for the comment. I think it can be easily explained, but that because we grow with some particular taste for every meal that we eat in childhood, and we love this childhood taste more than others, and it depends of if someone is ready to experiment with new taste or not. For example, if we talked about borscht, I admire very different type of borscht. It can be pitney borscht on a Christmas Eve without any, it's just a liquid. And I like with Central Ukrainian type of borscht with a so thick, with a, this stuff, it was all this plentiful of vegetables. This is beetroots, tomatoes, bell pepper, and so on. And it's absolutely different taste, but I like it a lot because I am ready to learn my taste to something new.
That's always good to learn something new about food. Mikhailo Chumak?
Yes, I was going to type my question in the chat. I'll include it for posterity. But I wanted to ask, you had mentioned that the recipe for borscht and the sorts of ingredients that go into it, obviously they vary by region, but also they vary by time period, you said. And I was wondering specifically with kind of major disruptions, such as the Second World War, were there any kind of specific variations in the recipe of borscht that were in response to crises?
Thank you for the question. Good question, actually. I'm not ready to show you exact sample of the that period of borscht, but the difference in recipes is also is because of accessible products. I think borscht is a very democratic food, and it is, as I say, food of opportunity. We add to borscht what we have. And I think in hard times, there is some of products were, was not accessible. We start to add, for example, sorrel or nettle or something. It's like every meal that we create to stay alive. It's like there is a very good sample, but it's related to borscht, but not not precisely. There is a meal called natina. It's a leaves or a different name is a volok. It's a all early spring herbs put together in a pot and boiled. Sometimes if you can, if someone can, it can add some sour cream or some oil maybe and something. But basically it is a food for survival. I think that this borscht is, it can be explained on the same example. We can add something new into borscht when we can access for something classic, to create a classic recipe. That's true, one and only.
Thank you. We have a question from Dr. Emily Channel Justice on YouTube. Can you talk a bit more about how restaurant culture is developing in Ukraine, and if how traditional cuisine is a part of that?
Thank you for the question. It's a hard question, really, because it depends. It depends of chefs who run the restaurant. It depends of owner. It depends of his free will to use Ukrainian cuisine in his menu. I know few very good samples when restaurants work with the traditional cuisine in a modern, in the modern perspective. They took some old recipe and rethink it with new products, with modern culinary techniques and modern taste of their possible customers. And sometimes it's very good, but sometimes it is absolutely not very good experiment. I know I knew a few of not good experiments also, but there is a one moment that Ukrainian customers who go into restaurant, it can be ready to taste traditional Ukrainian cuisine. Not that, you know, not their home cuisine, not that borscht that their babusa or mama making. They need to be ready, learn to something new, and this modern Ukrainian cuisine, contemporary Ukrainian cuisine. But I think this all can be, it is all the question of time, I think.
Thank you. We have a question from Isabel de Sisto.
Hi, so thank you for that presentation. One thing you said that caught my attention was when you mentioned the different types of some examples of borscht that are created for celebratory occasions, and you said that people have some special borscht that they use to celebrate the death of Stalin, and I wondered if you could elaborate on that.
Thank you for the question. For example, in Western Ukraine, a wedding borscht sometimes is mandatory prepared with millet. it can be an example of a specific borscht. But I think it is not about a recipe, but about how borscht became from everyday food to ritual food. It can be the same recipe, but the meaning which we put in this ritual food is more important. It can be our everyday borscht, but just prepared to the wedding, on the funeral, or something. It's like you always like more the your meal in a weekend than in an ordinary day. It's just all in our head.
I think I was actually curious though about the particular borscht that is for celebrating the death of Stalin. I wondered if that was, is that just an example, or is there more to that particular story?
The good example of holiday borscht is, for example, Christmas borscht. It should be meatless, vegetarian, and depends of region. It can be served with tiny dumplings, stuffed with mushroom, with prunes, with different stuffing. Also meatless. It's for Christmas Eve. The second, I don't know. I can't remember any other examples. But I have
a follow-up question. It's about the borscht, the picture, the photo with on Stalin's death. Do you know more about this photo, or who did that? Who prepared the borscht on his death?
It's like a very unusual story. This borscht on the Stalin death was prepared in a Ukrainian restaurant, which was in Washington D.C. I know that this woman on a photo, it was a waitress. But I didn't remember the name of the restaurant, and I even don't know is it exist till now. But it's my beloved photo about borscht. I think it is like borscht is a symbol of freedom.
That's fascinating. Thank you. We have a question from Andriy Smitsnyuk.
Hello, thank you very much for the lecture. I just wanted to ask you the question about origins of borscht. I personally grew up knowing that borscht originates from Ukraine and that it's Ukrainian, but I never really questioned my knowledge. And it's very common across Eastern Europe. But what allows us to say that borscht originates specifically from Ukraine, not Russia or Poland or other countries?
Thank you for the question. I think we can say so because now we're talking about Ukrainian borscht. Of course, exist different borscht, Polish borscht, Moldavian borscht, Lithuanian borscht, and so on. It was a common territory, and very tastes was in tastes and foods and the traditional of food making was in common. But I think in our territory, borscht shows this with diversity, this particular diversity, because Ukrainian is very Ukrainians create this borscht under their own tastes, and this tastes was multiplying agents to creation, to create new recipes. But in fact, we have no recipe for borscht. We have a lot of borscht and a lot of recipes. As I know, There is also a lot of borscht in different countries, but I think borscht is Ukrainian. It is almost a fact.
No, that's excellent news, actually.
Yes.
Do you have any other questions? Either live or through chat. Oh, that is from Larissa. Could you please ask it loud?
Yes, you made a remarkable note about proto-borscht from ancient, even Babylonian time. So I'm curious about how it was identified as a borscht, not a soup, not a other liquid meal, but how it was identified by historian as a borscht. So
thank you.
Caught my mind.
It was partly a joke, but not my joke. I saw this video when they recreated this recipe from the Babylonian tablets. And they, while they cooking it, they says, ha, this is proto borscht. And this, this word, catch my mind because, of course, it's not a borscht as we know it. Borscht can, it's, I said that this was rather a stew of lamb and borscht leaves. But I think this is a nice example to for using vegetables in the same way that we make. Making now. So this was not a borscht. It was a proto borscht. I will stand off them at least. There are many similar dishes in our past because it was a way to creation. It depends on what we put in our pot. But we can say about borscht, like in name it, maybe from 13th century, maybe a little before it. But I think it's not like they read this Babylonian table and read the word borscht. It was not this thing. Thank you.
Thank you. We have a question from Alexander Zavalo. Can you please explain how to enhance borscht to make it of a rich red and violet color? Thank you in advance.
Rich violet color. I know the answer. The color agent which can add this rich violet color is a beetroot kvass. It fermented for the 10 days maybe with a bread, with a little, with garlic, with celery and different, with sugar or honey, and this kvass have this not ruby, what, it's like almost violet, and then you and you should add this beetroot kvass into borscht in the very last moment, and it stay with this color. Thank you.
I do have my own question, if I may. The question about actually pork and sallow. I've heard actually that svinarstvo, yes, the production of pork for kind of widespread production of pork is a relatively new thing in Ukraine.
Yeah.
Probably since the, I don't know, late 18th century, 19th century. So how does obsession and stereotype of sallow and with pork, where does it come from actually?
I think it is like a I have no exact answer. I need to think about it. I think it's something like propaganda. I think like it was a very good picture of Ukrainians who are just very down to earth, in eat all salo, vodka and borscht, and it's like a pop culture picture. I think it is because of this, but of course salo was a very good product in a home gospodarstvo. Sorry,
in the home kitchen,
because salo can be easy to preserve. Pig is a very useful. It can be eaten from the nose to the tail. The popularity of pig is understandable, but this image of connection Ukrainians to salo, I think it is a different question. Sorry.
We have, thank you, that's quite interesting. As a historian, I found out to my surprise that svinarstvo, again, pork production, is a relatively new thing. In Ukraine, so that's why I thought, where does it come
from?
Yes,
it is new thing, because we have underestimated the history of shepherds, of the sheep and their quantity in Ukraine, because I think our history of feeding sheep are more rich than we know it, because now we think about Huzulian and sheep, but sheep was everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. Thank you so much. We have one very specific question from the YouTube audience member, Alexandra G, and I quote, "My aunt Katerina from Lviv added beans to a tomato and beef broth with the beets. Was that whole cloves of garlic in the video? I saw something small and white that was added." That's the question. I think it was garlic or...
Sorry, the last sentence of the question, because I...
sentence. I saw something small and white that was added. And I think it's garlic.
Something small and white. Maybe it is garlic, but garlic should be minced. I think some small and white. Maybe it is beans, small and white. I think it can be, because borscht with beans is very popular in Western Ukraine.
Thank you. Do we have more questions from the Zoom audience or from the YouTube audience? Okay, I guess we have one. Oh, just a second. Yes, one more from our participant, and I'm trying to find Christina Sorjan, I think.
Yes, Christina. Thank you. Mm-hmm. I have a question. What are some characteristics of Southern Ukrainian borscht, and was that in any way influenced by like Islamic culture / occupation through history?
South Ukrainian borscht. Thank you for the questions. I'm not very familiar with the South recipe of borscht, but I think from what I know, they preparing borscht without beets. It can be just tomato borscht or just cabbage borscht, but it is also have this specific sour taste and can be named med borscht, and they named this soup borscht. But I don't know. I can be more specific. Sorry, I need to read more about it, because my part is a Western Ukraine.
Thank you. We have one more question from the member of the YouTube audience, Yerema Misak. And his question is basically about sour cream and additives that you can add to borscht after cooking, yes? Is it common to add sour cream or stuff like that after the cooking process? Thank you.
Thank you for the question. This is interesting story about sour cream because it's like two different way to add sour cream. You can make підбивка, so-called підбиваний борщ. It's a sour cream with a little of flour, and you add while borscht still preparing. And you can prepare borscht without підбивка, because підбивка is actually a more Western tradition. And you can add sour cream after. And I think it is a question of taste. Some I know the people who didn't love sour cream in borscht and never add it. It's like it is all this variation, taste to taste of different people. I want to share one of the not very common after preparing additions. It's like boiled and mashed potato, which are served separately with borscht, in this borscht you should not put potato while it preparing, and just serve it separately with some fried onions or something.
Thank you. That sounds very tasty again.
Yeah.
One more question from Betsy Fawcett, please.
I typed my question in case my internet goes out again, but can you talk a little bit about vareniki and olivier, and if both of those are two of my favorite Ukrainian foods. So are those both truly traditionally Ukrainian?
Let's start from olivier. It's not an Ukrainian food at all. It's that Soviet food which migrated to Soviet cuisine from Russian Empire. It was French chefs was involved in created the olivier, but that original olivier have very in common with is modern oliviers. If we're talking about olivier, it's like a food of possibility. When in the Soviet Union was a deficit of different products, and olivier was created from components which was available, like green peas with potato with mayonnaise. It's like and it becomes tradition because it was a lot of choice to prepare something else. Olivier and the second vareniki. Vareniki is a very ancient tradition. It's very common in Eastern Europe cuisines, but Ukrainians have few recipes which are specifically Ukrainian. For example, with potato and fried onion and cheese, and with sour cherries, with farmer cheese, sweet or sour. It's our tradition. In Lviv, we have a specific vareniki, also called pyrogi. We have pyrogi with sweet cabbage, fried sweet cabbage. It's very tasty also. And Varenike deserves their own lecture for sure, because it is a long story and I just can remember all the interesting facts about Varenike now.
Thank you. That's very, very, very interesting question. And here is kind of follow-up question from Serhii Plohi. Where do you stand in Varenike versus pierogies debate? I don't know if it's all terminological or there is a difference actually in content, or it's
I know exactly where I stand in this question. I'm from Western Ukraine, and I stand for pierogi version, pierogi vlastivo, pierogi version, because it is tradition name for varenike in Lviv. But it is very funny conversation about pierogi versus varenike, because it is almost the same. The argument contra pierogi, it's because it is close to Polish names pierogi, but I think it is a different two words, and why we should think about how it names in Polish, in Poland, I think, pierogi. But if someone need to use the word varenike, why not?
that's a great debate. can I ask my own question? Maybe it's a bit too general. How many kind of regional cuisines you would find in Ukraine? If Galician can be one, what about Poltava? What about Central Ukraine?
There is a lot.
Kind of larger versions, kind of larger cuisines.
This is a very interesting question, actually, because every region have their own specialities. Galician cuisine, it's not like a stable thing. Galician cuisine can be divided on small parts, because, for example, Galician and versus Bukovinian cuisine, they are very close, but they are different, because on Bukovina they have a lot of Jewish influence on their in there, and it absorbs this Jewish traditions. In in Galicia we have also Jewish, but they was a little different from Bukovinian, and we have no dishes which I find in Bukovina. The very interesting local cuisine is Podilska kuchnia, Podilia cuisine. They had completely different influences than we have in Galicina. For example, Podilski borsch, if we're talking about borsch, Podilski borsch is very often prepared with a smoked pear, because they have this product and they put in borscht. Also, Podilia working use a lot of root vegetables in their local cuisine. Of course, Slobozhanska kuchnia. Of course, Crimean Tatars cuisine. Poltava region with varenike, halushke, all these interesting dough dishes. It's also there is a lot. It depends of it. It's sometimes we can find very interesting thing. I have a good example. For example, on a Polisa, Rivnenska region, Rivnenska Oblast. We have very interesting meat cured meat products, whereas nowhere else in Ukraine. For example, it's so-called palchubkhani kulbasa. It's stuffed. They stuffed kulbasa using its fingers, and then this kulbasa sausages was dried on a roof in a house. And it is a very local, very interesting tradition, which is how to explain what is this. It's like it's like Italian or Spanish sausages, but it is in Ukraine. It's very interesting because the climate in that region give an opportunity to make these sausages in that region.
Thank you so much. We have one question from Larissa.
Thank you. So some people think that without beetroot, borscht is not borscht at all. So I'm curious about origin of white borscht and in what region of Ukraine the white borscht is popular. Thank you.
Thank you. This is, if you remember, I told about that herbs, fermented herbs, like a base of borscht. There is a few base on which borscht can be made. For example, it can be grain kvass or fermented wheat kvass. The base of the white borscht is rye kvass or wheat kvass or sometimes oatmeal kvass. And the separate variation of white borscht is a borscht on a white beetroots, not on a red, just on a white. And the third variant of borscht, white borscht, is a borscht made on a milk base. It's a very local tradition, but is also called like a white borscht. From my observation, white borscht is mostly used on a western Ukraine, the far as western Ukraine. But in Lviv, we also used to do it.
Thank you for the question and for the answer. We have probably time for one or two more questions. So if you have your questions, so please, it's one of the last chances for you to ask your question.
I am always available on my pages. So if anyone will have any questions, welcome.
Perfect. Yes. Please tweet your questions to on Twitter, please, later, if you still have questions. And I actually have one again question from me, and it's a question about the concept of national cuisine. Does it require actually the culture of restaurants and going out? So basically, what I'm saying is not national cuisine is not what people eat at home really, but what it's can be presented and cooked at the restaurants. Yes, kind of. It's almost like it's PR rather than actual.
I think the national cuisine is a very good communication instrument with from the national to world. We can show something interesting to world, and the way how we rethink our national cuisine and show them to the people who never tasted and who never eat something like this, it is I think it is a very good like advertisement instrument. We all know Italian cuisine, Chinese cuisine, but in the world, Ukrainian cuisine is not known enough to be the good instrument. But my colleagues, we are working on it. I think sometimes it changed and Ukrainian cuisine be more popular, more is now on. I don't know.
That's fantastic, actual note to end our conversation. That was very inspiring and enlightening conversation. And I thank you very much from myself and from the audience. I think we all enjoyed your presentation. Actually, it was done beautifully. And I urge everybody to watch your blog. I myself just watched it. It's just fascinating. So please find Pani Mariana's blog, Pani Stefa, that's what it's called?
Yeah.
And it's on YouTube, yes? So.
No. It's a website, panistefa.com, and Facebook blog in the same name. And now I divide all my content on two sides. Pani Stefa is rather about recipe Seeds and Roots about more sophisticated things. It's like more about traditional, about old cookbooks, about my findings here on my Fulbright scholarship. And so welcome. And I always accessible in a Facebook, in a different chats. Welcome.
Thank you so much again. Hopefully we'll stay in touch virtually. Thank you, and hopefully see you all on next Friday. And Pani Mariana, also join us for our next seminars.
Thank you. Thanks a lot for opportunity to speak with, to communicate with so brilliant audience. And I hope someday we can meet in offline circumstances.
Physical environment and food.
Okay, thank you.